Hello, welcome everybody to this seminar. It is a pleasure for me to introduce to you Rafael Ramirez, who is a professor agregado in our department. So Rafael did his undergraduate studies in Mexico, and then his PhD in University of Bristol in the United Kingdom. And then he had an appointment as a lecturer at the National University of Singapore. And then he came to Barcelona to join our department. Rafael is currently a head of the Music and Machine Learning Research Lab, and he will today talk about the research that he's been carried out within his laboratory with his colleagues. So thank you, Rafael.
Thank you. So thank you for coming. I will, as Horacio was saying, I will be talking about what we do in our research lab. Our research lab is the Music and Machine Learning Lab, which is part of the Music Technology Group, and then we do research in music topics. Our research is funded by several projects, by one European project, the Maria Maestu program that probably you are aware of, and the Spanish ministry project called Timul. So thank you for the funding. I will talk about music learning and how we can use technology to enhance music learning, and then we can probably identify different kind of people that practice music. If I can. A bit painful. Oh, sorry, I don't want to do that. I cannot see my mouse. Actually. And then we can see all the kind of other people that have practiced a little bit more. And when we see person A and person B, we can ask a lot of questions. For example, how do you get the most natural question is, how do you get from A to B? Or why there are so few Bs? How many people have access to B and A? And the question we ask in our research, in the main question, we ask all these questions, but the main question is, how can we use technology to enhance the transition from A to B? So this particular research we are doing in our group is in the context of our European project called TELMI. It's a research and innovation action. And then we have different partners. We have technical partners, Genoa and ourselves, some pedagogical partners. Well, the partner is the Royal College of Music for the music part, and then some two companies or two industrial partners that deal with other issues of the project. So what is the motivation for doing this? You say, well, it's nice. Why do you want to really study how we learn or how to improve our learning in music? Is in the literature there are plenty of works reporting the benefits of learning music, not only in terms of being able to play an instrument, but there are other cognitive skills that you developed when you learn an instrument. Social skills, of course, motor skills, hearing skills. You have less probability of having diseases that relate to older people with in the brain. And then, so it would be nice, I mean, it's a nice thing to do, not only for the music part, but for the benefit it provides. Second observation is that there are this limited access to formal music education. If you take the whole population, only a small percentage have access to have music classes. And then worse still, the people that already have access, they are lucky enough to have access, there is a big or a large rate of abandonment. So many people all around us, when they were children, they used to play trumpet or saxophone, and they don't play anymore at all. They just abandoned. So the aim is to create or provide assistive interactive music education technologies that complement traditional teaching methods. It's not replacing, that would be arrogant to say we're going to, with technology, get rid of the long tradition of how to teach an instrument, but then complement them. And in order to widen the access of people learning music and lower the abandonment rate of people already studying music. And also, we want to investigate how do we learn music. So the project, as an overview, is student-centered. We have the students surrounded by sensors. The most natural sensors are microphones, of course, with music, and cameras for gestures, musical gestures. And then we have also the physiological sensors, such as EMG to detect muscle activity, EEG to detect brain activity, as well as other like physical sensors like accelerometers or gyroscopes to detect movement. And then these sensors are connected to a computer, and this computer on the one hand has access to a database of expert performances, people that are very good at doing what they do, and have recorded a multimodal data in the sense that they have recorded with all the sensors. And then this is stored in a multimodal database called RepoBIS, which has been developed by the group in many other projects. And then we can have, apart from the recorded data, we can have things that we compute from the data. For example, the velocity of the ball if it's a violin, or the spectrogram. We can compute from the audio, from the movement sensors, and then provide this synchronization with all the data, multimodal data. On the other hand, the computer provides real-time feedback to the student, and the data, this database, I cannot see my mouse. Let me see if I go with you. Ah, here. Okay. So, just to finish with this, you have synchronized data in which you have the audio, you have all the descriptors you want, you can compute or you record it, and then video and motion capture data. On the other hand, we have the feedback system in which we provide different kind of feedbacks, and there are plenty of things we can provide. We have been working with the students at the Royal College of Music who are high-level students. They are almost professionals. And then the most of the interfaces or feedback they want is in the score. They are based, the whole education has been based on the scores, on music scores. And then we provide like annotations on the score. If they play on time, they didn't play on time, they play out of tune or gesture information. And most importantly, after they play, we can summarize the mistakes or the issues they could work or improve on, and then we can give a summary in order for them to just focus on those ones. So also, this is the score, but we also provide gestures, information about the gestures, and then the idea is to provide a velocity position of the ball. This is a violin center project, and then so useful information for them to have, like how close or far away they are from the target performance, and they can compare with the target performances in the database. And then we have a social network that people, students can plan ahead the plans, the plan for studying, what they want to achieve and how to achieve that. And also they interact with the database, with the system, and they interact with each other. The students can upload data into the database, and the other people can comment on the data, and also they can communicate among themselves. So just to give you a very brief idea of what kind of data we're capturing, we have been capturing data from experts, and with all the sensors I said at the beginning, and we have the cameras, all kind of cameras. We have the high quality cameras, like Qualys cameras. We have Kinect, which is a 3D camera. We have normal cameras. We have microphones, ambient microphones, contact microphones that you can see in the next picture. And then we have also EMG. You cannot see them because they're below the suit. And then with this, we record from very basic exercises, so just sounds up to scales to concerts. So we have recorded material from the very beginning to the most advanced level. So this is very nice. And then how do we do this? There are a lot of places we can do analytics. We are a machine learning group. We apply machine learning. So this is like an ideal playground for a machine learning person. There are plenty of places you can apply machine learning. For example, you can analyze the system feedback that you provide and try to personalize according to the performance of the student, or different types of of systems, which ones have more impact on the learning process. We also can mine the user interaction, how they interact with the system, how they interact with each other, how they plan, if they plan and detect patterns of good practices or patterns of activities that lead to progress in learning. And of course, the multimodal database is a very nice place to do machine learning because we have data from different sources, and it's interesting to know how these different sources, the information in these sources, correlate. So, for example, one issue in the project is we cannot record, recording is expensive, so we cannot record every possible piece, every possible exercise that any student can would like to practice. So if it is not there, what can we do? Well, the idea is we could at least try to generalize from the recordings we have to recordings we don't have. So we apply, for example, in pieces, expressive performance modeling. We take a particular musician, an expert. We know how he played several pieces. We extract patterns, and then we get a new piece. We can just generate or simulate how he or she would have played the piece. What is expressive music performance? We have been working this topic for a long time, not only related to music learning, but expressive performance is studying what the musician adds to the composition of the music. So we have, what we listen is two things. One is the specification of the piece specified by the composer, plus, probably more interestingly, what the musician adds to this piece. If we just render, like automatically, the scores, music wouldn't be an interesting area or activity. It would sound very, very flat and robotic. The interesting part comes from the human that interprets the piece and applies transformations to make it sound more expressive. So how do we model it? On the one hand, we have the scores of the pieces. Then we encode this into some machine representation, and we extract some structure from the pieces. On the other hand, we have the performance, the audio, the recording, and then could be audio or could be the gestures as well. We obtain the recordings, and then we extract symbolic description by applying signal processing techniques. So we basically get like a kind of expressive score. We just detect onsets, offsets of notes, and energy, and so on. And then with the symbolic description and the machine representation of the score, we compute the difference. We know what is actually the musician adding to the performance. And together with the analysis of the structure of the piece, the score and the audio, we apply machine learning. We have applied many kind of techniques. We apply machine learning to obtain an expressive performance model, which we can analyze just to understand what's happening, when and how the musicians are introducing expressive transformations, or to analyze the model, which is not great. So we go back and change something in the description of the scores. And once we are happy with the expressive performance model, we can take a new score and apply the model and get an expressive performance in the same style as the performance we are modeling. This work is in our group. I've been doing this for a while. Sergio Giraldo has done he did his PhD in expressive performance in jazz guitar, and Fabio Ortega is a PhD student now working on violin expressive performance modeling. So we model several things. We model durations. When you have a score, you don't play exactly the duration you are specifying the score. You lengthen or shorten the duration of the notes. Then the onset, you advance them or you delay them. The loudness, of course, dynamics is a very important issue in expressiveness. How do you emphasize parts of the piece by playing it louder? Then we also model gestures and intra-note features like the envelope. We have been doing that, how the note sounds on itself, notes apart, and how notes are put together, the articulation. So we take a score, then we, of course, we focus on one note, but the note is not, focusing on one note is not enough to tell properties about the note. Most important is the context in which the note appears, in the musical context, either in melodic or harmonic context in which it appears. So we take features of the note itself, but also features about the environment or the context in which the note appears, and we characterize each note by a set of descriptors with this. If it is a polyphonic piece, we will take not only on the melodic line, but we'll take what's happening in the other melodic lines that are concurrently happening. Then we take the score and the audio, and we compare, as I was saying before, we compare, for example, duration, let's say. We take the duration, and we calculate the duration in actually that was played in the audio. And we calculate a ratio of lengthening or shortening. And then this is, for example, one expressive transformation, just duration. And we place for each note how much it was transformed in some dimension. And then once we have this, we apply machine learning algorithms. We have applied the typical ones, and also we applied very successfully one algorithm that is not used very often, is inductive logic programming, which just induces logic programs. And the good thing about it is that you can introduce in the learning process background knowledge. So you can just put in first order logic, kind of, your background knowledge, whatever you know about the music, and this will be incorporated into the learning. So the most efficient models that we have obtained have been done with inductive logic programming, which is normally not very much studied. Then we obtain, after applying machine learning algorithms, we obtain the expressive models. Then when we have the model, as I said, we can get a new score that we haven't used for training. Then apply the model, get an expressive score, would be like a MIDI with durations which are not exactly as stated in the score, and energy and so on. And then we can apply a synthesis engine to synthesize this. So we have just an example. I show you, this is work in the past we did with saxophone. So this is induced or generated by the system that has been learned from a professional saxophonist. You always have a problem with the mouse. Oops, let me see. Problems. It's not perfect, but it's much more expressive than what we would get from the straightforward synthesis of the score. So another area we are working on in the context of the project is normally you can see the score, and then synthesis is taking the score and of course synthesizing the sound of the score or the music, and the way back would be a performance information retrieval or automatic transcription. So we take the sound and we would like to know what is the score, but we can think of this when we generate music is not directly that way. The score produces some gestures. Whatever instrument you use gestures to generate the sound. The gesture generates sound, and the sound, or we can see the other way, we can from the sound trying to predict what kind of gestures produce the sound, and the same from the gesture to the score. This work has been done by Alfonso Perez, a postdoc in the group. And the interest of this, if you say, well, it's very nice, why do you want the gestures, is because normally gestures are difficult to capture even with cameras. So if you don't want to be intrusive, you have only cameras. So how do you calculate the position of the bow and so on, or the velocity you are applying, the force you are applying in the bow? So this also is a you can apply machine learning. You take the sound, you have a lot of recordings with the sensors, you have the sound, and the idea would be that without needing any cameras or sensor or movement detection, from only the sound, you could predict predict the gestures you are applying to generate that sound. So that would be great if that was possible in general, because you don't need the cameras, you just need a microphone, and with the microphone you are able to tell how much pressure you are using, how fast you're playing, moving the bow. This has problems because it works very well for one instrument in one room, but if you want to have different violins in different rooms, then what you have trained, it doesn't apply that much, so Alfonso Perez is working on this. Then Another topic that we are working on is because we have the EEG data of some of the recordings, so we are generating recordings with EEG data, is how this brain activity data that we detect with EEG correlates with learning. So then we have the musician, we record the audio, and we also record the EEG data of the person learning, and then from the audio we can compute some descriptors of how good or bad the person is doing. The ones we have been working so far is those ones, because they are complete beginners. So then it's just how accurate you can maintain the pitch of a note, how accurate you can maintain the volume or the loudness of a note. And then from the EEG, we compute some the typical bands in frequency bands, and then we try to correlate them. The preliminary results are, as I didn't say, Angel Blanco is doing his PhD in this topic. And then the results are preliminary, but of course there's correlation. What's happening in the brain activity correlates with the performance of the musician or the student. And if we record at the beginning of the trials, we do a lot of trials. At the middle of the trials and at the end of the trials, you can see, for example, in beginners that there is more alpha activity along the way, which means that also corresponds to what is in the literature. You have more free resources at the beginning. You are very concentrated using all the resources, and gradually you start to liberate resources. While advanced people that play the violin, but advanced students, they don't have this issue. Actually, there is a strange thing because it's the opposite, which shouldn't be. They get more concentrated at the end than at the beginning. And then this correlates with the measures of goodness. Also, one of the motivations, as I said, I mentioned at the beginning, was to wider access to music education, so allow more people to have the benefits of playing an instrument. And then one group of people that clearly don't have access are people with motor disabilities. People with motor disabilities, unfortunately, are not able to control fine movements which are required to play a musical instrument. So another area of research in our group is musical instrument learning for people with motor disability. So the idea is very simple. In a normal situation, we have the person with motor disability at the musical instrument, a guitar, a violin, or a piano. It's perfectly adapted to our hands because it was designed to fit our physical abilities. But when you have a person with disabilities, motor disabilities, the instrument becomes a problem. You cannot really, play the instrument because you don't have the skills that were supposed to be required to play the instrument. So what we do is build that orange box, that we build an interface that adapts well to the person with disabilities, and disabilities is a very general term, so this has to be treated in different cases. And then the interface fits very well triggers sounds in a very efficient way. So we have identified three broad levels of motor disability. One is the motor disability, like for example, for slight cerebral palsy, or you have control of your body, but not complete control or fine movement control. But still, you are not able to play traditional instruments. Then we have severe motor disability, in which you only maintain or eye movement control, but nothing else, or probably a bit of head control. And extreme motor disabilities, when you don't have even control of your eyes. This has been done mainly, there was the PhD thesis of Zacharias and other people, and a master's student also working in this area. So for the first one, what we do is if they can do, they still have some movement, which is not fine, but still have some movement. The idea is to see what is the best possible interface that adapts to what they actually can do. So then the typical process is we have a set of sensors, a lot of sensors. We have, for example, proximity sensors in which detect proximity, slide potentiometers, touch things, buttons, we have EEG, we have eye tracking. We apply all the sensors we have in the lab, basically, and to see which ones are the better suited for that particular person. And once we identify what are the capacities of the person in related to what sensors he can control, then we provide some design, we build the interface. For example, this was a guitar controller, and then we give it to them, and also we normally monitor how they learn. It's not just a toy. This is a musical instrument which has the same properties as a guitar. So you start being very clumsy, and gradually you get better and better. We quantify this. So for example, this was a German person who always wanted to play the guitar, but he had cerebral palsy, and then we built this interface in which he could strum with one roundy thing, and then he could control the chords because he could control only movement in one dimension. So I don't know, well, very, very, very quickly, but he has the chords. Oops, sorry. He has the chords, and he can control with that dimension, and then he's not strumming because you can automatize the strumming, and he's playing a concert in his center. So the idea is that we potentiate what he can do, and very often what happens, I don't know if you saw, he was using his right hand, he's using his left hand, and for the most of his life he was using only his left hand, the other one never used it. The moment he started to play, then he to get more accuracy, he started using other hands. So this is not only intellectual therapy, but it also helps in motor abilities. So then the second one is severe motor disability, in which you can only control the head or the eyes movement. And this was an interface built by Bambacousis. And then this is iHarp. And then you can just, by looking at the screen, triggering sounds and also chords. You can specify chords or arpeggios at the beginning, display, and then once you are happy with your arpeggios, then you can control the key or the chord you are doing with that arpeggios, and also play the notes. You have volume and so on. In this paper, it's not just a toy again. We evaluated the expressiveness of the instrument from two perspectives, from the player perspective, like how when you play how much expressiveness you can add to a piece, and from the audience perspective to see how this expressiveness is perceived. So for example, this is Zacharias, and we have been using this for example this is a child learning music with the instrument he has cerebral palsy, and he can only interact with the eye tracker. In the school, he only uses eye tracking. He cannot do anything else. I don't know. Well, and then the he's trying to learn. He's learning. But also, I think looking at this video, you say, well, it's like kind of entertaining. We have another person that uses. He was a musician. He has an illness that doesn't allow him to move the body anymore, and he is using the iHarp to play. Music, and you can do much more better than I mean, you can use it as an expressive instrument. For example, this while he was playing. A good point of this is being a digital interface, you can adapt it to the users as well. If you notice, this is a more complex interface than the one that the child was using before. This has like semitones in between, has more resolution, and has other features that you can individualize or personalize for particular users. Or make it as simple as possible. The analogy would be having a piano in which you can change the size of the keys, you can change the amount of notes you provide and so on, and then the moment you look at the key will sound. So you can do that depending on the expertise. And you can also, the idea is that someone starts with a very basic interface and gradually adds more and more functionality. Anyway. For extreme motor disability, related to brain computer music interfaces or brain computer interfaces, the idea is to since you cannot move anything, not even the eyes, or control the movement of the eyes, the only way to, and you still have a healthy brain, then the idea is to put a brain-computer interface and interact with the computer through your brain activity. So we have done several work, several interfaces based on this, mostly some of them based on P300 potentials. I don't know if anyone, I just explained very well what they are, but if you randomize some stimuli and you're focusing in one, when that happens, your brain triggers a spike in activation. And this is normally 300 milliseconds later after the event has appeared. So that's why it's called P300. And then by focusing your attention, then if you are detecting the brain activity, you can detect where your attention is, so where you are focusing your attention. So then we have, for example, this interface, that it was like a guitar, you could change chords, and you were focusing in only one. I wanted to change to A minor, for example, on the top, and then I just focused on that one. There were flashings around it. So each time that flashed, the A minor flashed, then my brain produced like a peak after 300 milliseconds, and after so many repetitions, the system is quite certain that you are focusing on that one, and it will change the chord to that chord, and so on. And then once you change, you focus on another one, so you can navigate a chord space by just focusing which one is the next chord you want to play. We have done also, like with P300, like the same idea as in the iHarp, in which you have a sequencer and you want to trigger sounds. Each roundy thing is a note, so you just focus on that one, and they are flashing. And then you will after a while, the system detects that you are focusing on that one, and it will trigger that sound. We have also more like switches. This is the only, I think this is video. I will just show you. This was a hack day, and it was an instrument in which there was a sound, and these are like kind of switches. So you have each row of two circles has two possible sounds, and by focusing on one of them, you change that switch, and then the arpeggio changes in texture. So probably, let me see. So suppose she already changed the first one, and the task was to change one by one, and then by focusing on the second one, each time there's a flash, and also the sound, you can also, the P300 are also generated by sound events, auditory events. So then when that sound is produced, then your brain has a spike, and that spike is detected in many repetitions, and then you change. So you could change gradually the texture of the sound by changing the one you wanted. So another approach we have taken for brain computer music interfaces is not only based on P300, but we have built emotion-driven brain-computer interfaces. So we detect the EEG, we transform this into an emotional indicator of the person, and then with this emotional state, we trigger whatever we want. In this case, we mixed the researching expressing music performance with brain-computer interfaces, and then the music is changed accordingly to your emotional state. So may I show you before I, for example, he's asked, you can map any emotional state to any music parameter, but here he was trying to relax to make the sound, the music sounds sound sadder, more sad. So he's asked to low down to make it sad, and he do it. He tried to put it down. But this is a kind of active listening. You are listening, but of course, the emotional state you generate will change what you are listening. This seems like a bit of, well, very nice, but why do you want to do that? And we have apply this to, as I will tell you, in practical contexts. But the way we do it now is not just general expressivity, it's not just how people play expressively and that's it. We have recorded the same pieces, a number of pieces, each of them, with a different emotion intention. We have as the person played this same piece, angry, played happy, played sad, and played relaxed, in a relaxed mode. So we build four different models for each performer. We have four different models, and then we applied machine learning to get the model. And when we have the model, we interpolate the models. We have different distinctive models with some parameters. We just interpolate these parameters to generate intermediate performances. And once we have this, well, we have the EEG, we obtain the emotional state of the person, we estimate the emotional state, and with that emotional state, we place which place in this arousal valence space the person is, and the music will be adapted to that emotional state or intention. So we have applied this as treating depression. We conducted a study in an elderly home with elderly people with depression diagnosed by the psychology of the center as depressed. And then we did this kind of neurofeedback system in which they could control the music with their emotional state in order to try to improve depression. This neurofeedback has been applied not with music, but in many areas, including depression. So we just included music in the equation. So everyone knows what depression is. The only thing to say is that people with predisposition to depression, they very often show an asymmetrical activity in the two lobes. So then they have normally more activity on the right lobe compared to the left, while people with no depression, we have a balance in activity. So they show more left frontal alpha activity. Alpha is inactivation. So they show less activity in the left, more alpha on the left. So the idea was very simple. So we try to encourage with the system to have symmetric activity. But that's the normal way to treat depression in neurofeedback. And then what we do is we have a neurofeedback system. The person is sitting there listening to music. Then we obtain the EEG data. The EEG data is transformed into some indicator of the emotional state into variables, into arousal, how excited or relaxed the person is, and how positive or negative the feeling is. And we place a coordinate in there. And then we have trained an expressive performance model, as I just mentioned before, with different recordings. And then we can apply this to MIDI music, which is easier because we can really change the durations, the articulation of the notes, or we can do that also with audio music, and we change only dynamics and timing. And then that sounds, and normally music has an emotional component, so this probably reinforces the emotion, and then this is a feedback system. And what we are asking the people to do is to try to make this music sound happier, which very, very roughly would be a bit faster and a bit louder, but not exactly. So they sat there for 15 minutes trying to do that, and just trying putting the state of a state of mind in which that happened. And then we repeated that 10 times along 10 weeks it was like 15 weeks or something like this. So there were 10 sessions, two per week. No, it's less than that, it's only 10 sessions. And then we applied a pre and post evaluation of a standard depression test. There was improvement of 17%, everyone improved. And then, most importantly, we have the EEG data. While we're doing that, we recorded the data, so we can analyze what happened within one session and from the beginning to the end of the session. And then there was improvement, significant decrease in relative alpha in the left arm frontal lobe from the first session to the last session. From the beginning of the first session to the beginning of the last session, there was a statistically significant difference in balance in how positive and negative they felt. And also, within one session, we analyze what happened every session. And you can see arousal, how excited is a bit changing, but it's not correlated with time. But the balance is a strong correlation. They feel better along the session. So we also have worked with autistic children. This is trying to extend. Before was active listening, and here is just passive listening. We use music just as a tool to try to help them identify emotions in faces, in people faces. So what we do is we asked them, we showed them faces from a academic database for studying emotions. We show faces with different emotions. We asked them what emotions they think they are representing. They fail initially a lot, the autistic children, because they have problems recognizing emotions. And then, as a second condition, we introduce music. When they see the faces, we play music with the same emotional content. So then we ask them again, and then they get better, of course, because they have the music that helps them to have to identify the emotion. But then we remove the music again to see if there was some residual effect. And then in one session, they could improve or not. And we repeat this as well in many sessions. And we see how, if they improve from the condition, first condition, no music, to the last condition in one session with no music as well, but passing through the one music condition. And then also we do it from the first condition of the first session to the first condition of the last session. And then there's improvement. They increase from 46% as a group of, they failed more than half of the time. They were wrong in the identify emotion. And at the end, they were 75% of verbal accuracy. But also we have the EEG. We work on the EEG. And amazingly, this is a pilot study because there were very few children. But initially, the emotional state decoded by our system is completely uncorrelated to the stimuli. So they see a happy face, they don't feel happy, it's completely random. But interestingly, we didn't expect this. At the end of the study, the emotional state decoded by the system is started to align with the stimuli we face. So this is not, we are not, if it is true, I mean, this is a pilot study, but it's not only training identification, just knowing how to identify, but also some kind of empathy with the stimuli we presented. The last one we have, this is the last thing I want to mention because I'm running out of time. We are currently working in a project using music as well, but this is in case music therapy in the Hospital de Esperanza, in the palliative care unit of the Hospital de Esperanza. They have terminally ill patients with cancer, so they there is nothing else they can do. The expectancy, normally the average of living they have is 2 weeks, so very short, in the last steps of their lives. And this hospital has a program for music therapy. So music therapists go and do music therapy to these people. It's not, of course, alleviating anything, but it's just improving the quality of life at the end of their lives. So music therapy is often seen as entertaining, many people think it's just like you play to them and so on. Music therapists get really angry at this because they see actual changes in physiological measurements. Well, not physiological, but they can see improvement in them. But they normally are not scientific oriented. They are musicians, so they never quantify what they are doing. And then what we're doing is taking the EEG and quantifying the emotional state along one session. We cannot do this along several sessions because, as I said, the life expectancy is very, very short. So we do it only once. And we have two groups. We have 20 people in the study group in which people come. There are like three musicians. They play music. There is someone recording the exact timing of events during the session. And then the second group, the same music therapists go and just give company, because it could be only the company that is improving the emotional state. They go and then provide company to other patients with no music. They just talk to them, and we record also the EEG signal of both groups. And then this is a ongoing project, so we have not definite results, but from what we have been analyzing, there is a significant improvement also in valence. Of course, they feel much better. We record at the beginning and everywhere, but we compare the beginning to the end of the session, and they feel much, well, what we detect is much more positive state of emotion state than at the beginning. And basically, we cannot do much more, as I said, because we don't have this repetition of sessions. I think you said 50 minutes and I 48, so I will stop here. Thank you.
Okay. So thank you, Rafael, for your very interesting talk. Any questions?
So I think I, yeah.
Thanks, Rafael. So maybe you can say a few words about these inductive logic programming methods that you are using, and why are they successful compared to other ones?
Yeah. I don't know. The inductive logic programming is not used very much because it's based on first order logic. So people don't like it, and it's not, you have to know about a bit how it works, and there are plenty of algorithms that work on the on this kind of formalism. But the idea is that you have some training data, as usual, and then apart from the training data, you want you can provide some background data, which is just background knowledge. So you can in logic, in first order logic, you can have like a sequence of clauses which specify whatever you want knowledge, and then when you try to learn the model, what it's actually trying to do is generate models which logically imply the background knowledge together with training data will logic imply what the model. So it's a logic it's induction in logic. And then why it has been working here very well, because in music has a lot of background knowledge. You can put many things that you know about the music, about the structure and so on. So this, instead of having to decode it, like or have it like a formalism that put it into the training data, you can have it a separate knowledge that can be introduced in the learning process. And also the models, most of the machine learning algorithms that we use for support vector machines and decision trees and so on are propositional in the sense that they could be specified with propositional logic. Propositional logic is just A implies B, no quantifiers. So then when you get these models from inductive logic programming, these are intrinsically more expressive because the model is a first order logic formula. So,
So I don't want to be more technical, but so this is a very difficult problem, no, to combine this type of combinatorial search in these structure spaces with more traditional machine learning. So maybe you can say how do you do it, because this is a non-trivial thing.
Yeah, you mean combine them?
Combining these.
Yeah, we haven't. There are approaches in which you can combine inductive logic programming with more traditional machine learning algorithms. So what we have done is apply directly inductive logic programming. And this, the issue you mentioned is complicated because the search space for hypotheses is huge. You have a much richer language in which you specify your hypotheses. So this is, of course, a bigger space. So that's why I say it's not kind of a weka kind of clicking and that's it. You have to impose restrictions on how you explore this search space. So you have to apply restriction how the length of your clauses. You can keep adding preconditions to your rules, or you can specify what's the shape of these preconditions should be. Not explore things that you don't want to explore because probably you know are not leading anywhere, and so on. So this is what it makes it more complicated. But then you get relational models as opposed to propositional models. Probably we can talk later about the technicalities and what kind of algorithms, because you can, there are two basic algorithms that you apply. One is top-down and bottom-up. You can start with an empty hypothesis that covers the whole space, your instances, and then specialize this into more specific hypotheses. Or you can take one instance in your data set and then have a rule or a clause for this one that only applies, and then try to remove preconditions from the rule to make it more general until you cover a more significant set of training data.
More questions?
Hi. Thank you for the interesting talk. I was wondering two questions. One of them is quite small, is for the treatment of the elderly with depression. I was wondering how far apart the sessions were. For example, if they had one session each month, their condition could have improved because, for example, it's Christmas and they get busy from family and something like that.
Yeah, that was a pilot study, and I have several kind of things that could be improved, but it was twice a week. It was two sessions a week, and during 5 weeks. So there was no holidays in between or anything, but certainly things happen on the way that can change completely the states. For example, in the process, one participant died, for example. It was a friend of them. They were living in the same elderly house, so they were close. And then the family don't come to visit them sometimes, so they are more depressed because they didn't come. The day before, they could have come and bring presents. Many things can happen, so we couldn't control on those ones. It was just from the outside and trying to quantify what we saw without taking this, because it would have been impossible to quantify all the things that happen in between.
Thank you. And the other question was, when you said that you had the model that you extracted at the beginning of the talk, and you had the recordings, the detailed models of the expert performance, and you could extract some, you tried to extract some models of the performance of the scores directly from the music when you had enough data of their performance. Right. I was wondering whether that could be possible with learners, because, for example, I guess in the casuistic is quite big. Not everyone has the same problems. For example, someone might have problem reading the script, but I'm guessing the problems with people learning music are going to be somewhat similar in different stages of the learning process.
Yeah. So that was one of the things we want to analyze. But it's not related really to the models. We are not interested at the moment, at least, to build models of the students, like models, expressive models, or how the style, how they play. But we can record the interaction with the system, so how what they are playing, and we can record exactly where they fail or where they do it well. So depending on where they fail, the system is work in progress, should provide feedback on what activities they should practice next. So, for example, this is very relevant with the Royal College of Music students. There are students, as I said, that are like semi-professionals. They are the best of the best, and then they always complain they don't have time. They can record themselves, but they will never have the time to listen to the recording to see what they did well or what they did wrong, because they don't have time. So, what they are really interested in is for the system to with some intelligence, give them a summary of places where they have to focus more. And not only, this would be in the performance, but they can be given not at the level of a particular piece, but in a more lower level, at the level of what exercises or techniques they should focus on to improve on these particular problems they have. So that would be like kind of personalizing the feedback to each student, because we have so much data. We have what they have been doing, how often they do it, and how well they do it. So we can then infer what should be doing, they be doing to improve what they are not doing well.
Another question there.
Thanks. I guess that the situation on this very question, for example, is very different when the music is not score-based.
Yeah,
but very, very different.
Like improvisation, you mean?
Improvisation or, I don't know.
Real-time composition.
Yes, well, real-time composition is probably another level. But,
yeah.
But improvisation, for example, or not even necessarily improvisation, but variations on a theme.
Yeah.
Even if the particular melodic aspects are present,
yeah.
Variations on a theme could be many.
Yeah.
And we would probably understand when there is something wrong, or I don't know. I mean, identification of certain issues may be significantly more difficult.
Yeah,
I guess.
Yeah. So we have in this project we're focusing on classical music, in which there is a score and so on. But in the past we have worked on other musics. For example, I was mentioning Sergio Giraldo's thesis was on jazz guitar. We had recordings in which the score had like 30 notes, but the person recorded 100 notes. Where did it come from? I mean, it's almost between improvisation. Of course, it has some similarity with the theme, but there are so many things that you do in between that is in the limit of improvisation. So the problem is very different, but can be we explored it by trying to build models of ornamentation. in which context you add notes, which context you remove, which kind of notes you do, and so on. So we study that. And then also we studied in the past, not recent past, free improvisation. In the saxophonists were playing whatever they wanted. And then the idea was to construct a score of what they played. Of course, like you have to quantify, and then to see how in this score, for example, dynamics change. So there was no fixed score, but once they play, we can analyze what they played and see the score. And we were identifying who was playing, for example. So we took a model of different saxophonists, and then just by these variations, we were predicting who was the of a new recording, who played it, just based on the style, not on the on the notes.
Thank you.
I have a question. When you study the expressivity features or characteristics that you can modify to make it
better.
So do you actually have an idea which things are better? So because you can have a recording that is not successful, that has modifications on duration and pitch or whatever.
Yeah.
So do you have this kind of information as well to actually select the one that will be better, or it's just for one individual and try to replicate how this individual will play?
Yeah, I mean, you are saying how do we identify the set of features we fit to the algorithm to produce a model, no?
Yeah, but I mean, if you have recordings, so some of the recordings could be successful because they are, I mean, they are variations that are actually good. There are variations that are not very good.
Yeah, I mean, we don't give features in the sense that related to a particular pieces. We give features related to the context in which notes appear, so the music material. And what we have done in the past is to extract as many features as we think are musically important, like the relationship with the previous notes, where the note lies within the bar, if it's a strong note, and so on. Things that when you play, you consider how you play the music. And then we get many. And then we normally do feature selection, and then reduce the set to get rid of the ones that actually in our data set, they don't provide much information. And then the problem probably you are mentioning is that what happens if you, for example, train on jazz data, and then you try to you give a score which is blues or rock or a different genre. This would be a problem because you are training on patterns of a specific genre and then trying to predict a piece which is not represented in the data set. And so we try to focus, to have a data set which kind of covers whatever music we want to synthesize or study later.
More questions? For people with disabilities, so they actually did know music before, or they were
We have different kinds. For example, the German guy, the one with cerebral palsy, he had cerebral palsy, very strong cerebral palsy, and he always wanted to play the guitar, but he had never been able to. So he didn't have any musical knowledge. He was very bright, but physically he couldn't control movement. So he started from scratch. And then the child I showed, so this is someone who always wanted to play music because his brothers play music and he cannot, so he didn't have he had never played any instrument, but the one I played, not the beat, but the video of the performance with the iHarp, that's a medical doctor who was a guitarist in the past, but then he developed an illness that didn't allow to play anymore. So he had all the musical knowledge. He just wanted a means to express what he wanted. So it's like a normal instrument. A piano, you give it to a beginner, they will start doing very basic things. You give it to someone that already plays piano, he will make more use of it.
So before we close, there will be some snacks, Mexican snacks, apparently, waiting for you. Rafael will tell whether they are.
The evaluation comes.
Thank you very much, Rafael, for your wonderful talk.
Thank you.